Welcome to another episode of Judgy Two Shoes. I'm one of your hosts, Steve Hofstetter.
I'm Savannah.
And together, we are the two shoes that will judge you.
Judging everybody.
We're judging everybody. That's the way this show works. We judge stuff on the internet. We judge stuff that you submit. We judge each other. We judge ourselves. We're judging. We're judging. That's the idea of the show.
Sometimes harshly.
Yeah. Sometimes favorably.
Yeah.
Sometimes harshly and favorably.
That's true.
Yeah. We're very harsh about our favoritism.
Yeah.
All right. So let's get the show started. And the first thing, always. This is the part. Do we have theme music? Can we play the theme music while
theme
I do this?
Theme music.
Theme music.
Theme. Okay. Did you find it?
And we're back. So today's episode, I just got back off the road, and it was just both of our birthdays.
It was both of our birthdays.
Yeah, our birthdays are, 3 weeks apart?
Yep.
Yeah. So yours late August, I'm mid-September, and together, those are
birthdays.
I have nothing to say.
I have nothing to say other than, like, how fun is it that we just get to, like, celebrate our birthdays? I know I'm more of a birthday person than you are.
Yes.
But it is fun to go from my birthday to your birthday.
Yeah. You're definitely more of a birthday person than I am, partially because my birthday is marked by one of the greatest tragedies in the history of America.
Yeah.
But, you know, aside from that, it's a lovely day.
Yes.
It's like late summer. Weather's usually pretty nice.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Except for the lantern flies.
That's true. My birthday always kind of sucked, though. Because even before the terrorism, by the way, my birthday is on September 11th for anyone who doesn't know. My birthday always kind of sucked because it was often the first day of school.
Mine was also almost the first day of school. So it was either on it or I couldn't celebrate because everyone was going back to school.
Yeah, I think Ohio started school sooner than New York did.
Yeah.
Because, like, New York would typically start early to mid-September.
Well, it's also gotten earlier and earlier each year. Like, I think the first or second week of August is now when they start. And it used to be, like, very early September. Then when I got to be about junior high school, then it was about my birthday. I think school started on my birthday 3 times.
Do you think that that is so that, like, the kids can get out earlier?
Like, I
so
have
they can enjoy May?
No, I don't think they get out any earlier.
No? They're just adding school now?
No, they might just, like, add to, like, fall break or something.
Oh, that might be why. So they add more stuff in the middle.
Yeah.
Yeah, as a baseball fan, I'm like, yeah, well, you know, the All-Star break is longer. So, like, the idea that the kids go to the All-Star game.
Well, they just keep increasing class sizes. So teachers, it takes them longer to get through the curriculum, probably.
I know that college would start earlier than, like, high school would.
Did but, it? I don't remember.
Yeah,
college. Oh, yeah, I moved into college on my birthday. On my 18th birthday.
Yeah, college would start typically in, like, late August for me anyway. But it's different around the country and probably around the world. There are probably people listening right now that be like, I don't even understand this. School starts in December.
I would be very interested in what a, like, year-round schooling would look like.
With just longer breaks in between?
I don't know the specifics. I have not looked into it that much. But apparently it would be, like, kind of, like, cut up into quarters. So then, like, they would have a little bit of a break, like, you know, 2 weeks or whatever, and then you go back to school, and then they would have 2 weeks, and then they go back to school, something like that.
Yeah, so the institution of summer camp would just be destroyed.
Except for the 2 weeks during summer that they would have off.
Yeah, but that's much less. But at the same time, I think gang initiations in the summer would have to be cut shorter.
Yeah.
Yeah, it'd be very important. You can't have, like, the longer initiation anymore.
But anyway, this is a birthday episode.
Yeah, this is a birthday episode. So this is the theme of the episode. We're doing birthday stories. We're doing birthday debates. We're doing birthday questions. And should we start with the birthday debate?
Yeah, birthday debate.
We're doing a birthday debate. We asked this question on the Facebook group and
it's
on
fine.
My Facebook page. And people didn't want to play.
People didn't want to play.
Well, they wanted to play, but they didn't want to play by the rules.
Yeah.
The question was simple. Do you prefer birthday cake or birthday ice cream? And there were so many people that were just like, either I prefer both.
Yeah.
Or, which is not an option in that, or I'd rather steak or lobster or a bowl of cereal or a sailing trip or just things that were not, this is not how you play Would You Rather.
No. If you can't play correctly, in my book, you're disqualified for any opinion ever.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Just for the entire future?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we're just going to disqualify our listeners.
Yes.
Yeah, there were a lot of people who did the, you know, por qué no los dos.
Yeah.
And I get that. Like, there are plenty of people who like cake and ice cream, but we're asking you to choose between the two.
Yeah.
If you only had one, if you had $5.
Yeah. No one likes cake and ice cream equally. That's also a very important point. No one likes them equally. And I don't care. It's like children. There's no way you love them all the same.
I was about to say the same thing. The idea that, like, people say, like, oh, I love my kids equally. It's like, no, you're lying. You're
yeah.
lying.
And it probably changes. You know, it can mm-hmm. change throughout the years. Who's your favorite, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
Same with cake and ice cream. But there's no way
yeah.
that if you're presented with two options and you have to choose between the two, that you wouldn't choose either because you want both.
If we have kids, can we name them cake and ice cream?
Yes.
All right.
And cake will be my favorite.
Ice cream will be my favorite.
Good.
And just like me, ice cream will melt in the sun. So, all right. I'm an ice cream person.
Yes.
I feel very strongly about this. I enjoy cake.
Yeah.
I don't enjoy birthday cake as much.
Okay.
Like, I find other cakes to be more enjoyable. And I guess you can get them for your birthday. Like, you can get a coffee cake for your birthday or something like that.
Okay.
But we're talking traditional here. Traditional okay. birthday cake. Which is typically either, like, the yellow cake or the chocolate cake. Okay, I guess we'll tolerate a red velvet.
Those are birthday cakes.
Yeah, but those are that type of cake.
Also, we're not tolerating anything. We're inviting welcomingly. Welcomingly?
I'm tolerating.
Red velvet cake.
I'm barely tolerating. Now, red velvet cake is quite good. But I'm more of a pie person than a cake. That was another thing, by the way, in the comments that people were like, what about pie? And be like, not an option. It is not an option for this. But when it comes to, like, traditional birthday cake stuff, I love ice cream
yeah.
so much. Now, I don't love all flavors, but the flavors that I like, freaking fantastic. And that's what I want.
Interesting.
Yeah.
You're wrong.
Okay, tell me.
Well, cake is better than ice cream.
Why?
That's the end. First of all, it's not cold. That's
yeah.
a very important part of enjoying my sweet treats.
Okay. Your sweet treats can't be too cold.
Can't be too cold. Because if you think about it, like, cheesecake is cold.
Yeah.
But it's not too cold.
That's true.
You know
it's,
what I mean?
It's not frozen.
Right.
Yeah.
I think that's a very important part of it for me.
Yeah.
I also don't feel like I am, like, getting anything out of ice cream, usually. Like, yeah, it might taste good. But, like, usually the ice cream that I enjoy is the ones with stuff in it. So, like, cookie dough chip from Grater's.
Okay.
Not sponsored, but will be.
Yeah. By the way, Grater's, sponsor us. And if you're unfamiliar with Grater's, you can Google it. You will not know how to spell it. It's spelled weird, but it's quite good.
And so, like, I need something in it to make me feel like I'm getting a sweet treat. Does
okay.
that make sense? Because, like, sorbet, I actually like sorbet quite a lot because I feel like the flavor is there.
Yeah.
With ice cream, I just don't feel that way unless there's stuff in it, like cookie dough and chocolate chip. And
well, I guess it depends on the flavor of the ice cream. Like, we went out for ice cream yesterday, and I got a banana cream pie ice cream.
Mm-hmm.
That was fantastic. It was really good.
Well, you like banana stuff.
I do like banana-flavored stuff. We did a whole banana debate in the last episode. We did the great banana debate. and so, you can get, like, the flavored ice
yeah.
cream. I had, there was this place I used to go to in LA that would have apple pie ice cream, which was fun. The whole thing would taste like that. They did a really good job, like, mixing it in. Ice cream isn't just, like, vanilla ice cream with stuff in it.
Yeah.
It's, like, you can flavor the
well,
ice cream.
Well, it is, but it can also not be.
Yeah, I guess that's true. All
Here's right. the other thing.
Good, because I have a point coming up.
It has been, like, almost exactly 4 years of us knowing each other.
Mm-hmm.
And I would like to make it very clear to everybody watching or listening, but you won't get my eye contact if you're listening, that Steve
yeah.
has never, one time, bought me a birthday cake. And I love cake.
That is true.
So however, just for future reference,
yeah,
I like a good two-tier white cake
mm-hmm.
with whipped icing, not buttercream icing, whipped icing. It
yeah.
should be pretty much the consistency of whipped cream.
Okay.
It's delicious. It's way better. And anybody who argues with me can hop off.
All right. Well, this year, we are actively working on our weight. Like, both of us are, like, working out for the wedding. So getting a whole cake would be a terrible idea. I have killed it on birthday presents.
You've killed it on birthday presents. I've sucked, for sure.
No, no. This year you did a great one.
Yeah.
Well, we don't know yet because I haven't gotten to use it. But it seems like it's going to be super fun. She got me a round of golf or a round of, like, a driving range from the top of PNC Park in that's where the Pirates play. And so, like, I'll get to hit golf balls into a stadium, which will be so fun. Yeah, you basically combine two things I enjoy a great deal. That would be as if I got you a Taylor Swift cake.
Yes.
Put them together. I have never been to a birthday event where there isn't a lot of leftover cake. And I don't mean, like, from the cake itself. I mean people take cake on their plate and they don't finish it. I rarely see unfinished ice cream.
That's because ice cream has no substance in it.
What?
There's just nothing in ice cream.
So you're saying it's not as filling?
Yeah.
Well, maybe that's good.
It's not good.
That's not good? You want to be filled
with cake? I want to feel like I am treating myself, and I don't feel that way with ice cream.
Every time I have ever gotten a bit, like, I've had to learn, do not get as big of a piece of cake as you want to get. Because every time I've gotten cake, and I've been, like, genuinely excited about it, I'm like, oh, this is going to be great, and oh, I have this big old icing part, and that's just pure sugar, that's so fun. And then I just, oh, I feel terrible afterward.
Well, it sounds like you're getting the wrong icing, like mentioned earlier.
Okay.
And two, so it sounds like icing. You're not all that into commitment. And I think that's something we should discuss on this podcast.
We should discuss whether or not, yeah, there's going to be lots of leftover wedding cake.
Mm.
Yeah, I am such a pastry person. I am a huge fan of cannolis and eclairs and, like, those little fruit tarts and, like, all those kind of things. I'm a big fan of pastry, but not a big fan of cake. I find most birthday cake much more boring than, like, a good pastry. And one of my favorite things to do, whenever I play shows in Vegas, the casino will give, like, you either get the regular buffet or you get the employee buffet. Either way, you're getting unlimited ice cream and unlimited pastry. And what I will usually do is I will pick my favorite pastry from whatever they have selected, and then I will put it in the bottom of an ice cream bowl, and I will put ice cream on top of it. And that, to me, is heaven. Now, I know...
Which sounds like you need something else to make your ice cream that wonderful to you.
No, it's just fun to make, like, pie a la mode. Mm. But it's just, I find just regular standard birthday cake to be a little boring.
Have you ever wondered what it would be like to be right?
I've wondered that throughout the history of this podcast.
Yeah.
The 8-week history of this podcast.
Just make it 8 weeks, wow.
Yeah, this is week 8. What's the 8-week gift?
Like paper.
Yeah, like paper or diamond or whatever it is.
Yeah, I think 8 weeks is diamond, actually.
I thought eight week is subscribers. if listeners could be the gift for the 8th week.
That would be nice.
Yeah. Okay. We're clearly going to disagree on this. Tell us what you think in the comments. Don't do the whole what about birthday cake and ice cream. Like, if you have to choose between the two. I love the, like, gun to your head, because I'm like, what a weird assailant to have a gun to your head and be like, either ice cream or cake. Be like, this is the best robbery ever.
I didn't read through the thousands of comments, like,
there
all of them.
There were so many comments.
But if any of you said Jell-O, I don't want you to be a listener.
You're kicking off listeners now. Yeah, Jell-O is for children and shots. And... post-surgery.
Yeah.
Like, when you have no other choice.
Exactly.
That's it. Yeah. Judged.
Judged.
Kind of. Judged.
You.
All right. We judge you. Now it's time for the group submissions.
Group submissions.
So.
Group submissions.
We had a post in the Facebook group that asked people for their birthday stories that we could judge.
Mm-hmm.
And it was interesting because some of them told horrific stories that I would never want to repeat.
Right.
Some people didn't really tell stories at all. They told stories in the way that, like, an art house film tells stories, and that it was just, like, a snapshot of a day.
Yeah.
And then some people had some good stuff. So we're going with the good stuff.
Good stuff.
Good stuff. All right. This submission is from Kelly Hun or Kelly Hune. I don't know, but bear with me. 20 years ago, I was in a long-distance relationship with a man whose birthday was days after mine. He waited until after I told him I had mailed his gift to break up with me. He didn't even return the gift I sent him. I think that's a dick move. He should have broken up with me before I sent the gift. I had talked about it for a few days prior to going to the post office or return the gift so I could get a refund. That's a tough one. If there was intent on his part,
yeah,
then that's very scammy and gross.
Yeah.
But also, when you get someone a gift, are you getting it as a down payment for future gifts from them? Or are you getting it...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, even if his intent was not to be like, oh, I'm going to get my gift first.
Yeah.
If you knew prior to that that you were... But you were just waiting until you were together or whatever.
Yeah.
And it was an expensive gift, I think the right thing to do would be to give it back.
Yes.
To expect it back, that's not really why you gave them the gift.
Right. The right thing on his part to do would be to give it back.
Yeah.
Unless he specifically was waiting for the gift. That to me is the evidence that, because also, like, I don't want a reminder from an ex.
Yeah.
Like, there are definitely things that I wouldn't want to hold on to.
Yeah.
What do you think of the people who, after they break up, want stuff back?
I guess it depends on what it is that they want back.
Okay.
Like, am I keeping something at their house that's, like, technically mine? We just both use it when I happen to be over there.
Yeah.
Or is it, like, jewelry that was given to them?
Yeah, because, and I want to be clear, I'm not talking about the idea of, like, oh, we broke up, so I'm going to get all my stuff that's at your place back.
Yeah.
I mean, the people who, okay, my ex had an ex.
How dare you and them?
I know. How dare everyone? My ex had an ex that after they broke up, he sent her a bill for a trip they went on together.
Like, no.
That is tacky. In fact, for the first, I think, 2 or 3 years we were together, I thought she always referred to him as Bill, and I didn't know the backstory.
That's so funny.
I thought her ex's name was Bill, but it was just because he sent her a bill, and so that's what her and her friends all called him.
That's so funny. I love when things like that happen. Like, I have somebody that I call Fuck John.
Yeah.
And, like...
How dare you?
I know. Yeah, so... But
it would be amazing if I thought that guy's real name was Fuck John.
I have a similar-ish story.
Mm-hmm.
So, when my ex and I broke up...
How dare you.
I know.
But also, good.
Thank God. we had already bought a house together.
Yeah.
And we had a shared bank account. And a lot of the money in that bank account was... money I had put in, and we had discussed when splitting that money was mine so that I could keep the house. Like, you know, they always look at your bank statements when you refinance, yeah, etc. Homie took money out, and then we had a conversation and he put it back. And then about 6 months later, the house is already mine, whatever, I get a Venmo request for that amount of money. And with the subject line of, like, the money you guilted me into giving back or whatever.
Whoa.
I don't remember exactly what it said, but it was very funny. So I just declined it.
Yeah.
He sent it again. I declined it. And that was the end. There's been no communication, really, yeah, since then.
I've never blocked anyone on Venmo.
I don't even know if you can. You block somebody on Venmo?
I'd imagine you can. Because, yeah, if someone's asking for, you know... Like, every now and then, I'll get someone who just asks me for money.
If you, like, Venmo. Accidentally press accept or something?
Well, I just decline those. I decline those. So I guess I would have to block the person on Venmo, which would be,
yeah,
weird. But I will tell you this. If anybody wants to Venmo me $5, I'll totally add you as a friend on Venmo. You want to be my Venmo friend? You want to be my friend, Mo? So, if, at Steve Hofstetter, I think that sort of thing is tacky.
Yeah.
And I understand that, like, I'm in a good financial position now, but I certainly didn't used to be. And even when I was in a mountain of debt, I also owned a house with an ex. And I know how dare.
Well, just
I.
Don't.
Yeah.
It's hard for me to say don't do it to people because yeah. I truly think I would do it. I'd do it over again, kind of.
Well, you were engaged.
Yeah.
Like we had just been dating a while. We did have an agreement of how things get split up if we, you know, we had it on paper.
Yeah.
Of how things get split up. And we had like a choice of one of us could buy the other one out or we could sell the house and split the proceeds. Now, of course, in between the time when we bought the house and when we broke up, the market dipped.
Yeah.
So, like, we were underwater on the house. So if we sold the house and split the loss equally, it would have screwed us both. And the idea was, okay, maybe I'll try to hold on to it and see if it, you know, it could work out. And I also made the decision that while this would hurt me a great deal financially, she would never recover.
Yeah.
Like, if we had done this equally, I would have been just as screwed, but she would have also been screwed.
Yeah.
And so I just made the decision to just deal with it financially, and I'll work my way out of it, which I did eventually.
That's so nice of you.
Thank you. I just don't find the idea of that little bit of financial pettiness, and this was a freaking house, let alone, you know, like someone's portion of a trip, or someone's like, well, you know, I bought you Burger King 3 times. And that,
yeah.
Yeah. Like, I've seen stories about that kind of stuff. And that's just so gross.
That's also very similar to, like, I don't nickel and dime my friends over anything.
Yeah.
If I buy you lunch 8 times in a row and one day you buy me coffee, I consider that even. Especially, you know, depending on the money situations on both ends.
You want to get lunch?
Yeah. And I'll use your credit card.
No.
And
it's backfired terribly.
And so, like, especially in relationships, like, I cannot imagine, like, that back and forth. Especially, like, with my ex, I had given back the ring.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, I had given back stuff that, like, could be sold.
That's another thing, by the way. The people who keep the ring.
Yeah.
That to me is pretty petty and pretty tacky.
Yeah.
Like,
but I am keeping the ring between us.
Oh, nice.
Well, we're getting married. So
well, yeah, you should keep that ring because it is yours. But yeah, I think that it also depends. There's a difference between a divorce and an engagement.
Yeah.
In a divorce, that's already their ring.
They earned that ring.
Right. They earned that ring. An engagement, if you call off the engagement, that ring was part of that.
Although, like, I do think technically by law it is the person you gave it to.
It is, absolutely. Yeah. But this is not what is legally we should do, but what someone ethically should do.
So tell me how you feel about this then.
Okay.
So when we broke up, my ex and I...
How dare you.
I'm the one
also
who...
thank you.
I was the one who currently had the job making the money to pay for the house.
Yes.
So I kept the house. But he had moved in first. Yeah. I hadn't moved in yet. And so I had told him, hey, you need to get your stuff out by, and it was like 5 days later.
Yeah.
When I got into the house after that 5 days and he told me he was out.
Yeah.
He had left a lot of stuff in the house. At which point I then gathered up most of it.
Yeah.
And gave it back to him. Like, we met up, I handed him bags of stuff. He didn't ask me for anything else.
Yeah.
I did keep a couple of things that we either didn't pay for or we split the cost of.
Okay. I assume these are gifts and not things you stole.
Yes.
Okay. Just making sure.
So, like, pots and pans.
Yeah.
A shark vacuum.
Okay.
Which I love.
Yeah.
And then I do still have a couple of clothing items that I just love and I don't want to give back. But I did give back his favorite sentimental hoodie.
This is a very specific situation because he was the one that left.
Yeah.
And when you leave, you are abdicating a lot of your typical responsibilities, especially if you leave during an engagement. Like, that is, it's very different when you break up with someone versus when you leave them. There's a difference.
Yeah.
When you break up with someone, you know, pre-engagement, like, you're still both independent. Your stuff is your stuff. Once you get engaged, you start merging stuff.
Yeah.
And when you merge stuff, it's a lot more complicated. I think in that situation, especially because you gave him the option of, like, come get your stuff, and then he didn't, the fact that you gathered it and gave it to him is a lot nicer than most people. Most people would have gathered it and sold it or burned it or thrown
it
away.
My favorite part was mm-hmm. one of the items left in the house.
Yeah.
I didn't want him to bring to the house anyway. I was like, I don't like this. Can we not put it in the house?
Yeah.
And he insisted. He wanted it so bad. It meant so much to him. He loved it so much. Left it in the house when he left.
Yeah.
So I had to gather it and put it back and put it in a bag and give it back to him.
Yeah, which was ridiculous because it was another woman.
Yeah. My favorite.
Just put her in a bag. And
my favorite part was when I walked into the house and, like, there were hangers on the floor.
Mm-hmm.
We had a electric couch, you know, that you press a button and it.
Yeah, the zhuzh couch.
Yeah. It was half reclined. They couldn't even press the button long enough for it to fully go back. It was just, like, half reclined.
So he was, like, packing up. It was a long day. He decided to sit and recline halfway because he's like, I can't do this the whole way. Yeah, I think that, I guess to go back to the birthday thing, it really depends on why you got someone the gift.
Yeah.
There are some people, the people who, like, give a bill after a relationship, like that sort of thing, that means that you were treating that person as a sex worker and not as a partner.
Yeah.
Because you were paying for their time. You were paying for their intimacy.
Well, I think people also use, like, money or gifts or anything like that as just, like see what I've done for you.
Yeah, it's a power thing.
Yeah.
Although I will say that one of the reasons why I'm sympathetic to Kelly here is because, and now this wasn't a relationship, but I've definitely been on dates where, like, the person waits till right after the check comes to let me know that, oh, you know, this was fun, but I'm not interested in you in that way.
Yeah.
Like, I've definitely had that happen. And it's like, oh, did you not figure that out 4 minutes ago?
Yeah.
Like, were you looking at the check and been like, you know, based on what he ordered?
Well, because here's the other thing is, like, if I had planned on paying on a date
mm-hmm.
and they told me in the middle of the date that it wasn't.
Yeah.
Like, what we thought it was going to be, I probably still would have paid. Like, honestly, $25 or more, even 50, like, not worth it. It's not worth, like, the pettiness, yep. like...
It's the conniving that yeah. bothers me. It's
yeah,
the,
yeah.
Yeah, there was one woman that I referred to, because this happened at a sushi restaurant.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, she's the one that wanted to go for sushi. She ordered a decent amount of expensive stuff. And then immediately after the check came. Like, and she didn't even do the, like, reaching for the purse. Like, it was just, you know, clear I was going to pay. And, like, immediately after the check came, she was like, oh, you know, this was fun, but, you know, I'm interested in you as a friend.
Yeah.
I referred to her among my friends as the fish thief. Because this whole thing was just a way to steal fish from me.
That's so funny.
So, yeah, she will forever be known as the fish thief. I say forever be known. I don't think I've mentioned her in, like, 4 years. But, okay. So
for Kelly, my judgment is...
Yeah.
Intent on both parts.
My judgment is... Because he didn't give the stuff back, it seems like he was intending on getting the gift.
Yeah.
Like, he was intending on keeping the gift and knew he was going to break up ahead of time. And for that, you just... I judge him.
Yeah, did he know what the gift was going to be?
Yeah, she said... Well, she said that she had talked about it for a few days prior to going to the post office. So he either knew it was something special or he knew exactly what it was.
Mm.
So in that sense, I think... I mean, even if he was just like, oh, I'm curious what this gift is, and then I'm going to keep it. So I judge him.
I judge him. Partially. Okay.
Yes. By the way, if you want to participate, go to our Facebook group, facebook.com/group/judgy2shoes, and submit your stories. You can submit them anonymously if you would like. This is from Rita Pethel, or another way to mispronounce it. Would you continue to get a birthday gift for someone every year, even though they never reciprocate, although they make plenty of money? In other words, money is not the issue. They tell you they don't believe in making a big deal about birthdays and that they don't expect others to buy them anything, although they do accept the gifts. What would you do? I
think this goes back to intent. Why are you giving them a gift?
Yeah, if someone doesn't want a gift, don't get them a gift.
Yeah.
Like, you're not obligated to get someone a gift. My family isn't much of a gifting family.
Yeah.
I think I've even talked about this on the podcast already. Like, we're not good with birthdays typically. We're not, you know, it's not a thing for us. I know there are some families or friend groups that make a big deal out of it.
Yeah.
But it just depends on the relationship. I know that you are a birthday person. I know you love your birthday, so I'm going to go out of my way to get you something awesome.
Yeah.
I think it's cool that you got me the golf thing, but if you hadn't gotten me anything, I would have been okay.
Yeah.
So I think it just depends on the person you're giving to.
Have you ever forgotten a birthday that you, like, would have bought a gift for if you had remembered?
Oh, I'm sure I have. I'm forgetting that I forgot a birthday right now. And then after this episode, you're going to ask me this again. And I'm going to be like, oh, I forgot a birthday. I'm sure that I have. In relationships, I'm pretty good about it. Although, you know, in previous relationships, I certainly wasn't as financially comfortable as I am now. And so gifts were often more of like a token.
Yeah.
Of like, you know, oh, here's a cool thing. Here's an experience. You know, we'll go to dinner or something like that.
Yeah.
You know, I'll cook. Here's a macaroni necklace. You know, like whatever I could afford. So, I think now it's a little bit different because I can kind of go out of my way and do something really cool.
What does that person do for their birthday? Do they still want to, like, all get together and, like, do a big thing for their birthday, but they just don't do that for yours? Or is it purely just the gift? Is it, like, specifically the bought present wrapped up in paper or a gift bag that they don't reciprocate on?
So my 40th birthday was the first time that I really celebrated since my 22nd, because that was, you know, when the world almost ended. So what I did was I got a couple friends together and we all went to Vegas. And I paid for a lot of it. Like, I bought a cool Airbnb that we all stayed in. That was when I still was willing to use Airbnb. And it was a lot of fun. And, you know, they did things here and there. Like, we went to dinner and they made sure I didn't pay.
Yeah.
But I didn't care if anybody gave me a gift. Some people flew to Vegas. That's that's plenty. Like, I just wanted the experience of it.
Yeah, I think it depends on what they do expect for their birthday versus what. Because, like, if I knew my friend really wanted gifts for their birthday, they didn't care about going out, they didn't care about what they like are gifts.
Yeah.
Then, yes, I would get them a gift. But, like, I like going out, I like going out to eat, I like doing something, I wouldn't expect them to get me a gift because I got them a gift. I would expect them to do what I wanted for my birthday, which was going out to eat, going bowling, whatever it was that I wanted to do. That would be my expectation, not necessarily a gift. Does that make sense?
It does make sense. And I think that I never thought about this before, but I have a different love language when it comes to relationships and when it comes to friends.
Yeah.
For me, in relationships, it's words of affirmation and physical touch.
Yeah.
For friends, it's quality time.
Yeah.
Like, for friends, it's that making the effort that really is important to me. You know, and they say that's the thought that counts.
Yeah, that's interesting. I think my love language is the same. And it's the quality time.
Yeah.
And acts of service.
Yeah. My love language is not, I know some people it's gifts, and I always find that to be so funny. Because, like, my love language can be bought.
Okay, we can go into the whole thing, and I am sure we will have plenty of comments telling us what the gift love language actually is. But I love gifts.
Yeah.
It's just not the way that I feel most loved. But, like, I think, I mean, as always, a combination of all the love languages is important.
Yeah. And, you know, fans often bring gifts to shows. And it's interesting to see the difference where some fans are like, this is something he would really enjoy.
Yeah.
And some fans are like, this is something I would really enjoy. And therefore, I'm going to hope he enjoys it as well, or assume he enjoys it as well. And sometimes people get things for me that I'm just like, this is not something I can use at all.
Yeah.
Sometimes people bring me booze, which I bring to you.
Yeah.
But, you know, I'm...
Keep bringing him booze.
Yeah. As a sober person, it does not really work for me very well. But it's... or, you know, the people I'm on tour with can partake. But it is interesting to see when people, and this isn't just fans, this has been people in my life also, when people make the effort of like, oh, this is something he'd really like, versus, I like this, and therefore, I think the perfect gift is a gift that only the buyer and the receiver, like, it would only make sense between them.
Okay.
That's the perfect gift. When it's something that, like, if anyone else could also buy for you, you're just saving them a little bit of money. And if you could buy it for someone else, then you're not really doing much. Whereas, like, okay, this year for you, I got you a commissioned art piece of Taylor Swift. And I understand anyone could buy something like that for you. But I was able to get it because the artist follows me on Instagram. And so I was able to reach out and be like, hey, can you bump this up in your queue? And,
yeah,
you know, et cetera. And so it was something unique. Whereas, like, if I had just gotten you signed memorabilia from eBay,
yeah,
that wouldn't have been as much. Do you know what I mean?
I do know what you mean, but you just told the entire world that I'm terrible at giving you gifts.
No, because you got me the hitting golf balls off of PNC Park is such a creative gift that I didn't even know existed.
Yeah.
And, like, that is something that is very, very unique. And part of the gift is also going with you.
Yeah.
Which I guess technically someone else could have gotten me a pass for two and said, bring you. But it's an experience. And so that's why it's good.
Judged.
Okay. All right. This is from Dana Degenhart, known to our fan community as the Bunster. My best and oldest friend and I have an ongoing joke / disagreement / battle every birthday and holiday. She insists that cards / presents not be opened until the actual day. Well, I think it's fine to open them at any time, especially the cards, as I can have them out and enjoy them before my birthday / holiday, awaiting judgment. So this is something that you and I have discussed as well.
Yeah, because we're opposites.
Yeah. I am happy to get the gift whenever.
Yeah.
And so I think it's up to the person. It's, you know, again, a gift is for someone.
Right.
And so if the person wants to wait, they can wait. I got that art piece for you 3 months before your birthday.
Yeah.
And then I just hid it.
Mm-hmm.
So, because
you actually made me get it from the... It was delivered. You said, hey, this thing was delivered. Would you please take it over to Steel City? I had to leave our home, so go to Steel City.
It was delivered while I was on the road. I thought it would be delivered while I was home, and it wasn't. And when it was delivered, obviously, I don't want that sitting outside.
Yeah.
I don't want it rained on. I don't want it stolen. And so I pretended it was something for Steel City. And I asked you to bring it to Alyssa. And you did. And then she hid it. And then I got it a few months later.
What would she have said if I was like, oh, let's open it?
I think she probably would have made up an excuse of,
yeah,
why she couldn't. You know,
we're really going to stress out Alyssa at some point.
Yeah. Yeah, we're just having her keep all our secrets. So why don't you want to open things until your birthday?
I think it just goes back to the fact that I love my birthday so much. And so, and I like I love Christmas. Like, I don't, yeah, want my Christmas presents until Christmas. And I think it's just that, like, it makes that day better. Anytime you get to open a gift, it makes that day better. So I want it on my birthday.
See, and I'm the other way where I go, ah, my birthday is already going to be fun. I want to have a happy moment now also. But you did a great job because the golf thing wasn't going to be available until like 2 weeks after my birthday.
Yeah.
So you just told me what it was on my birthday.
Mm-hmm.
And you also gave me the option. You were like, do you want to wait to find out or do you want to know now?
Yeah.
Now, if you had said that to me a week earlier than my birthday, I still would have been like, yeah, I want to know now. You know, I want to know. Like, to me, surprises can happen anytime.
Yeah, 2 years ago,
mm-hmm,
I got you presents for Hanukkah.
Yeah.
Just as, like, a fun thing. Like, you hadn't gotten presents from me and, like...
It was very, very nice of you.
It was just a thing. And they weren't, like, crazy or anything.
Yeah.
There were a couple of, like, you-specific ones, a couple of, like, funny ones, a couple of, like... things that I had just learned.
Yeah.
I went online and learned about Hanukkah. And I was like, okay, you can have... I think it was actually the day before. Like, it wasn't even sundown.
Yeah.
Like, it wasn't even... it wasn't even Hanukkah yet, technically.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay, you can have them all now. You can have one a day. You can have a couple a day and whatever. And Steve opened them all immediately.
I was like, now. I want them now. I want to see what they are. Yeah. And they were great.
Yeah.
Nice work. All right. Judged.
Judged.
Let's go to a Reddit story.
Reddit story.
Ooh, do we have a new theme song for Reddit stories?
No.
No? Okay. We already know these because we do a game sometimes. The thing that started the podcast was that we would just read these to each other when I'm on the road or even when we're just both in bed.
Yeah.
We would just read these stories. So we did these on the last road trip, and they were birthday themed. So we decided to keep them. All right, ready?
Mm-hmm.
Am I the asshole for ruining my friend's surprise party? My 26 male friend, Emily, 27 female, has always been a huge fan of surprises. So when I learned that her boyfriend, Alex, was planning a surprise party for her, I asked Alex to help plan, but he said that he wants this to be a special plan made from her boyfriend of years. Feeling left out, I thought I should also make a special plan from her friend of years and organize a surprise party of my own for Emily. I planned a surprise lunch for just the two of us at her favorite restaurant on the same day as the party, but at a different time. My intention was to give her a double surprise and make her day even more special. On the day of the surprise party, I picked Emily up and took her to the restaurant for a regular lunch. When we arrived, Emily seemed genuinely delighted. Well, turns out I got the times wrong. Oops. Or maybe lost track of time. But Alex and her friends were waiting at her apartment to surprise her. She received a text message from Alex asking where she was. Confused, she called him, and that's when she discovered the truth. She was devastated and felt angry that I, who knew about the party, didn't tell her, or at least guide her back in time before any of the paid bartenders and workers left. Her party was set up in the apartment party room. It turns out that Alex had been meticulously planning this surprise for weeks, and I completely ruined his efforts with my own surprise. Emily was upset, not only because she missed out on the party, but also because she felt like her boyfriend's money/time/ideas were wasted. When I realized my mistake, I felt awful and apologized to both Emily and Alex. They were understandably hurt and disappointed in me. Our mutual friends also agree with Emily and Alex, as they had all been looking forward to the surprise party and felt left down by my selfish actions. Now, Emily is still upset with me, and we haven't talked for 6 days. I can't help but wonder if I am the a-hole. I genuinely wanted her to have her party, but she was ordering food left and right. Am I the asshole? Yes, the hell you are, and Emily is not going to sleep with you.
So, okay, yeah, clearly OP wants to fuck Emily.
Yes.
That is obvious here.
Obvious. So painfully obvious.
Here's how I, like, back when we read this the first time, how I knew immediately that they were the asshole.
Yeah.
Was even in the subject line, it didn't say accidentally ruined.
Yeah.
It said ruined. So you know you ruined. Like, you legitimately ruined it. You were the reason.
Yes.
Two, it flips, the reason of her missing the party flips from A to B to C.
Yeah.
So, like, first it was, I just, like, forgot the time or didn't know the time or ran late or she was ordering too much food. Like, what's the reason?
Yeah, it was, he gave three different reasons. He said he got the time wrong. Then he said he lost track of time. And then he said she was ordering food left and right.
Yeah.
Also, for the paid bartenders to have left.
That was a decent amount of time.
At least an hour. There's no probably way that they two. Would have hired them for only an hour. Probably two. So, odds are, this lunch started at the same time as the party. And then ran long. Like, even if you take a friend that you haven't seen for a while to lunch, and you're catching up forever, max 90 minutes.
Yeah.
Maybe 2 hours, if you're really just gabbing away.
Yeah.
And she's ordering food left and right. Like, shut up. This was absolutely purposeful. This guy was upset that the boyfriend is more important to her, and we have corroborating evidence in the comments.
Yeah.
He confessed in one of the comments, well, not really confessed. He said that when they first met, he was attracted to Emily. But, oh, they're way beyond that now. That's what he said.
There's just no way.
Lies.
It makes me so angry. And it makes me angry for Emily specifically because she, at this point, has probably thought that, like, they were friends.
Mm-hmm.
That, like, at this, if, you know, if it's been years, she probably thought like, oh, this is somebody I can count on.
Yeah.
And possibly it has been an issue between her and her boyfriend in the past that they had probably moved on from. Then this probably caused a fight between the two of them.
I would bet. Well, I think actually this is probably the straw that broke the camel's back of their friendship. I think, if anything, the boyfriend was very vindicated on this. Because for the boyfriend to say, no, I don't want your help with this surprise party, clearly he was like, get out of our lives. I've had enough of you. I've had enough of you meowing around my girlfriend's leg in hopes that she one day will be single. Or cheat on me.
Yeah.
I think that the boyfriend was absolutely right in saying you are not part of the surprise party.
And I think it does sound like they were good enough friends that they, like, not only would just know about the party, but would have been invited to it anyway.
Yeah.
So, like, you for sure had the time and the date and, like, all of that. Take no as an answer when someone doesn't want to fuck you. Like, take them being in a relationship as the no.
Yeah, the just waiting around in hopes. Also, if your intent was to give her a double surprise, wouldn't it have been great to do it the next day? Because the idea is she just had the surprise party. She thinks that's her birthday celebration.
Yeah.
And then turns out you have one more thing. Also, how did he surprise her by taking someone to their favorite restaurant? That's a date.
Yeah.
Like, that is absolutely a date.
I was going to say, in the beginning, the first sentence of him explaining what he was going to do was a surprise party of my own, then says, we're just going to have lunch, the two of us.
That's a surprise date.
Yeah.
Yeah. This is the type of person who would invite her to, like, oh, we're going out with seven friends. Oh, five of them canceled. I guess it's just the two of us.
I would love to know, like, her version of this story. I would like to know exactly what happened from her perspective.
Oh, I think her version is, well, I was trying to go see my boyfriend, and then this guy I knew once in college kidnapped me. Like, this is not... I would guess that he is overestimating or overstating how close they are also.
Yeah.
Like, if they were still that close, he would have been in on planning the party whether or not the boyfriend was comfortable with him or not.
Yeah, maybe.
Because he would have been such a part of their life for so many years.
Would you, if I had a very close guy friend that you thought wanted to fuck me and then asked if he could help you with my surprise party, would you let him?
I don't think you would have a close guy friend who wanted to fuck
you. Yeah, that's so true.
Like, what I'm saying is, like, if it was the point where they're actually estimated, like, if, you know, I mean, and look, I'm assuming a lot about these people. I'm assuming a lot about these people's emotional intelligence. But if she had any inkling that he's trying to fuck her, then I don't think she would be as close with him as he is saying they are.
Yeah.
So either she's completely naive or he is overstating how close they are. Yeah. Like, this could have been like a, hey, we haven't hung out in a while. Let's do a catch-up lunch. Not you know, my best friend and I get together every Tuesday.
OP is an asshole.
OP is absolutely an asshole. OP Dutched. Should, yeah. OP is not only an asshole, OP is an incel. All right, judged.
Judged.
All right, one more?
One more.
Okay, this one's a bit of a long one, but it's fantastic. This is one where a lot of these Am I the Asshole stories are, well, you know, this person has their perspective and the other person has theirs. This is one where this person cannot see it from anyone's perspective except their own. This is... Okay. Oh, this is a good
one. I don't even remember which one this is.
Oh, you will in a second. Am I the asshole for telling my girlfriend that she needed to apologize to my friend after she went off on her on a trip? This weekend, I took a little friend vacation with my close friend group. A few of them invited their significant others, and I have been dating my girlfriend now for a long enough time that I don't think it would be awkward to bring her along. So my girlfriend gets along with all my friends very well, excluding one. My friend Jessica is a very nice girl, and in a lot of ways is very similar to my girlfriend. I think that this is just one of the cases where people who are similar just repel because on paper they should be very good friends. Agreed with your head nodding. They aren't outwardly rude to each other. However, it's clear they just don't vibe. So three things happened on this trip that led to disaster. One, first, our day there, we planned on going to the beach. While we were getting ready, my girlfriend realized and told me that she was feeling bloated and she forgot to pack a one piece to wear. I told her we could just chill in the room and she said she wanted to go down to the beach, but we should go buy one at the resort shop. On our way down, we ran into Jessica and I told her we were going down to the shop to look for a new bathing suit. Jess then offered to let my girlfriend borrow one of hers. My girlfriend immediately rejected it and said we'd buy one. Two, we were at a bar drinking and dancing. Jess is only like 5'5 and probably less than 130 pounds. She's also pretty much skin and bones, so she's a lightweight. Eventually, she got pretty lit and was finding everyone trying to get us to take a shot. When she got to us, I was down, but my girlfriend wasn't. I told her it'd be fun, but she said no. Jess said we were being boring, so I took a shot with Jess. This set her off. Three, the final issue was that the next day, me and my girlfriend were late for breakfast because we were getting intimate and lost track of time, which was wrong of us. So apparently, Jess said she'd come get us, as she walked past our door, she said she heard zoo noises, and then she went back to everyone else and said we were occupying each other in maybe a minute. When we got downstairs, the group was cracking jokes, which I thought was no big deal. Then they said that Jess heard us, which my girlfriend got mad at. This was apparently the straw that broke the camel's back. My girlfriend snapped on her and told her that Jess had been catty to her all trip and she's just trying to have a good time. She told her to stop being such a pick-me bitch to her. This caused Jess to cry. I told my girlfriend she needed to apologize to her and resolve whatever beef they have. My girlfriend said that Jess needs to apologize to her for acting like she did, that I'm being a dick for taking her side. We've been fighting about this since we got back, and now things are awkward with Jess. My friends are split on this, as some think my girlfriend is being overboard, while some think that she may have a point, which I don't understand. Am I the asshole? Wow, you are so clueless. And by the way, when this guy's girlfriend leaves him, at least he has Jess waiting in the wings.
So true.
Yeah. This is the flip side of the story we just read before.
Yeah. So, breaking it down.
Yes.
First, let's start with the bathing suit. That was the first issue he brought up. Yes. Which, by the way, probably means it's the 127th issue.
Yes. Yeah, if these are the three issues he noticed.
Yeah.
Yeah, there was way more.
So, the bathing suit issue.
Yeah.
This one actually ties in to the second issue, which I'll get to in a second. But Jess offered a bathing suit of her own.
Yes.
In the second issue, we find out Jess's height, weight, skin and bones, whatever.
Yeah.
If your girlfriend is feeling badly about the way that she is looking as far as her weight goes.
Yes.
Something tells me the two of them are probably not the same size.
Yeah.
And it would probably almost be embarrassing to, like, try the swimsuit because it probably wouldn't fit. Or and yes. If you're feeling bloated, you need something with a little bit more give, you know, to, like, hide or at least feel like you're hiding it.
Yeah.
There's two issues here. One, you have now perfectly described Jess's height and body weight and the way that she looks. And you felt very comfortable putting all that out there on this Reddit post.
Yeah, he could have just, in the second one about the drink, he could have just said, she's a lightweight.
All you had to say was, but no, you described the way that she looks.
Yeah, he was basically like, she's a lightweight because she used to model.
Yeah. So then, your girlfriend doesn't want to drink.
Yeah.
She's done drinking. She's good. Jess comes over and says, let's all take shots. Your girlfriend says, no. Jess calls your girlfriend boring.
Yes.
And you go, yeah, we should take a shot. So you take a shot with her. Okay, yeah. Of course that's going to piss her off.
Yes.
Jess is trying to get you drunk.
Yes.
Third issue. If you are on a trip.
Yeah.
And a couple doesn't come down for breakfast.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously. They're busy.
Yeah. Either fighting or fucking.
Yes. One of the two.
And you should not interrupt either one.
Yeah. And of all of the friends, Jess was the one that... First of all, no one needs to go get them.
Yes.
but Jess was the one that needed to go get them. Who cares? If they miss breakfast, they miss, like, sucks for them.
Yeah.
Like, they're not a part of breakfast anymore. Like, that's the way that goes.
Yeah.
But no, Jess probably wanted to catch them fighting, but instead caught them fucking and made sure everybody else knew about it.
Yeah, the zoo noises thing, absolutely ridiculous. Okay, I'm going to go through these three as well.
Mm-hmm.
And I've got some other reasons why Jess is a terrible person.
Go for it.
And a pick me, for sure.
Mm-hmm.
So the first one about the weight. If your girlfriend is feeling sensitive about her weight on that given day, you do not bring it up to anyone else.
Yeah.
If she, even if he said, oh, well, we're going down to the store to get a swimsuit because we forgot to pack one. Even if he said it that way, still, it's none of your damn business.
Yeah.
We're going to the store. Like, keep your girlfriend's secrets.
Yeah.
Okay? Especially when she's feeling self-conscious.
Yeah.
The second one, someone who wants to force someone else to do a shot, they're boring. You're not boring because you know your limits. They're boring because they are acting out whatever they saw in a dumb teen movie when they were a kid. She's boring because she needs alcohol to replace her personality. So when your girlfriend says no, even if you want to have another drink, the idea of you taking the shot with the person who just insulted your girlfriend,
yeah,
in a woo moment, like, what a jerk. And then the third one, absolutely the idea that Jess was the one that went upstairs to go see them. And her acting like it was like a big deal and a funny thing to embarrass them in front of the group. Like, oh no, a couple on a vacation had sex with each other?
Yeah.
What a thing to discuss. Like, come on, grow up. These people, by the way, they're all 25 and 26. They should be more mature than they are in these stories.
Yeah.
And absolutely, Jess is waiting around for this guy and trying to get in the way.
Well, and here's the other reason that I know that Jess and the boyfriend are in the wrong.
Mm-hmm.
So the girlfriend is not a part of this friend group. This friend group was already established.
Yes.
And then girlfriend comes in. Also, was girlfriend named in this whole thing?
No.
But Jess was. Okay.
Yeah. Fictional name for Jess. I bet the girlfriend's real name is Jess and he just, like, switched him.
So girlfriend is not a part of this friend group.
Yes.
Jess is a part of the friend group. And half of the friends are saying that Jess was in the wrong.
Yeah.
That is how I know that boyfriend and Jess are assholes.
Also, I'm guessing half of those friends err on the side of female.
Yeah.
Because they actually can see what Jess is doing. Even if these things that Jess did were more borderline, you still take your girlfriend's side.
Yeah.
It is your girlfriend. She is upset by something that one of your friends is doing. So you don't say, you need to apologize to my friend. You, try to figure out why. You just be sympathetic. You just listen to the concerns.
Yeah.
And like we said, there's no way these were the only three things.
Yeah.
There's absolutely no way. I bet at every meal, Jess somehow was seated next to him.
I also bet it started 3 months prior.
Yeah. I bet this is something where, like, it's just been constant. Yeah. Absolutely this person is the asshole.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Judged.
Well done.
Questions.
Let's ask each other some questions.
You go first.
All right. So my aunt used to get us these gifts that she would call just because presents.
Mm-hmm.
And they would be, you know, small things.
Yeah.
Do you prefer a present on, like, a birthday or Christmas or some sort of occasion? Or do you prefer getting a present when you completely don't expect to?
On an occasion.
On an occasion?
Yes.
As you have the mug that I got you. as a Just Because present?
Listen, I love Just Because presents.
Yeah.
I think those are also important, but that was not the question.
I know it wasn't.
The question was one or the other.
I know.
And I prefer occasion presents.
All right, fair enough. By the way, you can't see it now because it's cold, but this mug, when it gets hot, says "You are my natural treasure" with a picture of Nicolas Cage because that's her favorite movie. Yeah, I think, was that the first gift I ever got you?
Yes.
Yeah. That was fun. I just saw it on, I just saw it online.
It was either that or my birthday present the first time we both lived in Pittsburgh.
No, I think this might have been first. Yeah. I think this was first. It was just something, I saw it on Instagram and I was like, oh, yeah, she'd love that. Have fun.
I love Just Because presents.
Yeah.
Don't get me wrong. But I also have an issue with people, so like Valentine's Day.
Yeah.
Okay. I like Valentine's Day. People who are mad about this made-up holiday, like, you need to take a breath. Maybe get a drink of water. It's a fun thing. And the argument they always use is, well, you can just treat someone like crap 364 days a year. But if on Valentine's Day you get them roses, then you're a good boyfriend? That's stupid. I'm like, correct. You understand.
Yeah, don't treat them like crap the rest of the year.
Okay, yes. Also, but yes, I'm sure it's a commercial holiday, whatever. Whatever. It's fun. It's cute. Mm-hmm. You don't have to spend a ton of money on it.
Yeah.
Like, if you are dating somebody who is mad that you didn't spend a lot of money on it, that's a different issue. But celebrating Valentine's Day or posting on Facebook, I don't need to buy my wife 12 roses on Valentine's Day because I treat her well throughout the entire year. And then you post a picture with your wife and say, Happy Valentine's Day. You're the worst. You're the worst person in America. Like, I just can't stand it. I can't handle it.
I can't wait for us to do a Valentine's Day episode. You also know that, like, I'm not much of a holiday person.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, I'm someone who, I think the Valentine's Day surcharge is a little ridiculous.
Mm-hmm.
And it's something where, like, I would much rather take you to dinner on the 13th or the 15th.
Well, but that's not even the point, though, is, like, you're still celebrating Valentine's Day.
Yes.
And if I wanted to go out on Valentine's Day, we would go out on Valentine's Day.
Would.
You wouldn't post on Facebook about how you don't have to celebrate Valentine's Day because you treat me well most of the year. Because I can tell you, the people who post that don't treat their partner well throughout the entire year.
I want to see the receipts. I want to see the rest of the year.
It's like Danny's joke. Show your work.
Yeah. I think that sometimes people are doing that just because they want to be different. They, you know, they think that being contrarian makes them interesting.
Yeah.
Whereas, like, if you like the holiday, great. If you don't like the holiday, also great. Just have fun either way and don't worry about other people pressuring you into it.
Yeah.
What's your question?
My question is, well, I can't ask you what your worst birthday ever was.
Oh, but I have others that were bad.
I was going to ask, what's a runner-up?
So, obviously, the tragedy of September 11th was my worst birthday.
Yeah.
Your
birth, though, yeah.
I had a history of bad birthdays. There was one where it was the first night we spent in the new apartment after my parents separated.
Oh, yeah.
There was one where I was the, there was one where I started a new school after going, the first day of school when I was 12, after going to school with, like, the neighborhood kids my whole life.
Yeah.
Then I went to school in Manhattan, and had to completely try to fit in all over again, and it did not work. That was my birthday, but the absolute worst aside from the terrorist attack was I was the sole witness to insurance fraud arson and had to, like, talk to the cops. This is real. We were pulling out of our driveway. This is the house I grew up in. So I think this was my 10th birthday, maybe. But, you know, I was still a kid. And we're pulling out of the driveway. And I see a car on fire. And, like, it's this, like, it starts as, like, a small fire. And I see a guy who was, like, parked next to it, just kind of, like, driving away. But I was the only one facing that direction because my mother had a station wagon.
Yeah.
And so I was sitting in the back facing that way. And So we, like, you know, called the fire department, and they came in and they put the fire out. And then they were like, did anyone see who started this fire? And I was like, I did. And so I had to, like, spend my birthday talking to the police and the fire department.
That's so funny.
Describing the guy.
Oh, no.
Yeah. So we didn't, I don't remember where we were going. I don't know if we were going out to, like, get food or ice cream or, you know, whatever. But I was, instead, we had to, like, stay there for an hour or two while I talked to the cops.
God, birthdays are insane.
Yeah. Although, again, not the worst.
Not the worst.
It was fun. Someone in the comments wrote that they were, like, they were going to complain about their birthday because it's Christmas Eve.
Mm-hmm.
But then they remembered what my birthday was. I was like, yeah, kind of got to be.
No, I think it's so valid that people who, around Christmas time,
mm-hmm.
like, hate their birthday. Because I think that probably starts when you're a kid hating it.
Yeah.
Because, one, you either get lost in the Christmas thing, or, like, it's probably hard to have a party with your friends because many of them are probably out of town.
It's actually good to have a Christmas birthday when you're Jewish because that's the one way you feel like you'll fit in around Christmas. You're getting gifts, too. So then it's okay. But, yeah, anytime you have a birthday on a major holiday, whether it's Christmas or New Year's or, you know, in the States, July 4th or something like that.
Like Labor Day weekend. People are always gone. Like,
yeah. Yeah, it's tough to have a celebration around that.
Mm-hmm.
I do really enjoy having a September birthday in that, like, the weather's always nice or almost always nice.
Yeah.
But, boy, does my specific one suck now.
Yeah, I do like that I have a summer birthday.
Yeah.
Just because, you know, I had pool parties for my birthday and, like, that kind of stuff. Having a winter birthday has got to suck.
A February birthday in Minnesota.
Ugh.
There's definitely people who have to deal with that. And I can't imagine.
Why would you live there? I mean, obviously, kids. Kids can't help that, but.
Yeah, that's you're gonna be cold. That's they light the candles on the cake just for warmth.
That's funny.
All right. Anything you want to tell these lovely people?
No, other than this is the closest we've ever recorded an episode to releasing. It's the night before.
Yeah. Yeah, we got to do some editing immediately.
I know.
I have a whole bunch of gigs coming up, including Washington, Pennsylvania, which I'm very excited about because I get to sleep in my own bed after that gig. But I have a whole bunch coming up, and then of course there's the huge Australia trip, and I've started slowly releasing tour dates for 2024. So if you want to come see me live, please do so. Tickets are on my website, stevehofstetter.com. And if you want to support the podcast. You don't have to give us money. You don't have to buy things. You can, however, subscribe and rate us, review us, do all that stuff. If you go to judgy2shoes.com, it takes you directly to the Apple Podcast page where you can write a nice review. And also, please share it with your friends. We hang and chat live on the YouTube stream every week. So that is Thursday at noon Eastern, 9 Pacific. And so come hang with us and talk with us.
Also, watch and share the reels that we post.
Yes.
Because I have never dealt with this before.
Yeah. This is
but I am struggling.
This is the first time Savannah is dealing with the being at the mercy of the algorithm.
Yeah.
And so, like, we had, you know, most of our reels get between 15,000 and 25,000 views. And then we had one that's doing quite well, and it's at almost 40,000. And the next reel was doing so poorly that Savannah was like, we're deleting this. This is bad. We're deleting it.
It had like 2,000 views.
Yeah. If you do enjoy our reels, share them, please. Put them in your story. Comment on them. Send them to friends. You put that little mail icon thing and it helps.
Argue with people respectfully?
Yes, in respectfully the argue in the comments. That helps a lot. Yeah.
All right. That's all I got.
All right. Excellent. Does that mean it's time for the awkward goodbye?
Awkward goodbye?
This is the part. Do we have theme music? Can we play the theme music while
theme
I do this?
Theme music.
Theme music.
Theme.
Okay.
Did you find it?